So, Jeremy, you chose animation to tell this story. It's obvious that the hand needed to be done that way, but do you want to talk about how animation exaggerates or emphasizes the things about the human characters?
No.
Okay, cool. We're done. Look, you're working independently, which it sounds like it gave you an opportunity to try a completely different approach to animation. I want to talk about innovating in the context of all the animated films that are out there.
Yeah, I think today maybe the film can be here also because last year your film was also received so well.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, you remember?
I do remember, I blacked out, honestly.
And we remember in French. And I think this kind of film will help animation to move forward and to bring something new to people, to audience, and then the audience will need to have something. It's like a circle, virtuous circle. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And me, I think we don't need to justify why we are doing animation for adults. I don't like to justify myself when I do animation. But people are not aware of that, and we have to educate people. And your film did that very well, and it opened the door. Sometimes the door is getting closed again each year, and another film is opening the door. After my film, maybe the door will close. I don't want this. And right. So our duty is to keep the door open.
Your movie premiered in Cannes.
That was the first I'd heard about it. Was how it was a big hit of Cannes, and so I was really excited to see it. What was it like?
It was the first release of the film, and because we work very alone with this film, with my producer and the team, it was really nobody heard about this film before Cannes, and where we get exposure at Cannes, it was like very rewarding for us and the team, and it was this moment which only cinema can bring. Yeah. At the same time, the film is not falling from a truck. I mean, we're working really hard on this film with only passion, only artistic purpose. It's like a very independent film. And so our purpose was to bring something new, and we knew that it was new in animation. So, but you never know how it's going to be accepted.
Of course, you must have been so nervous sitting there in a big fancy theater.
Yeah, the first screening was a bit stressful. Yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine.
But it all ended
and
up.
Sometimes people laugh when you doesn't expect them to laugh. Sometimes they don't laugh. And it's opposite thing. So, no, you never know. The film is not belongs to you anymore. It's not being.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. That's incredible. And you won Critics Week.
The first animated film to ever win Critics Week. That's pretty incredible.
Yeah, and I didn't realize it was the first time in the history of Cannes that an animation film won the Critics Prize. It's just after they told me that. And it's great to know that in Cannes there were. People were talking about cinema, film, and not animated film. It was only about what you can bring with a story, not your technique. And people were talking about the actors, and so it was really a good signal for the film.
Well, we always say that animation is not a genre, right? It's
I say the same, yeah.
And what do you think about, it is about the movie that it was considered alongside of all of these live action films. It was taken just as seriously.
Yeah.
Right? As but all of these live action films that were shot with actors in the camera. They're, you know, the jury at Critics Week clearly didn't see a distinction.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, the Critics Weeks already take a short film from me. So they are open-minded to see that animation can talk to adults. But the difficult part is how you bring people who are used to see animation for kids' purpose and the opposite to the live action, which is for clever purpose. And so it's hard to bring people to watch animation with a new, fresh eye.
Well, all summer in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. people were coming up to us and saying, have you seen I Lost My Body?
Really?
Yeah. In Cannes, and you guys have to check it out. It's the, you know, it's the bee's knees. I don't know how to say that in French.
Looks funny.
Phil told me, Phil saw it before I did, and told me how amazing it was. And then I saw it on Netflix with my entire in-laws, people from ages 16 to 75, and everybody was completely engaged the entire time. And I was surprised what a broad range of adults were captivated by it, because I think the thing about it is that it feels very visceral, very emotional, and you're rooting for this severed hand, which is a crazy achievement. And how did you convince people that to make this movie? Because it seems like you kind of have to see it to understand it.
I think it was a job of my producer. And my producer is the one who called me to adapt the movie from Guillaume Laurent. And me, I'm coming from short film, and I wasn't dreaming about feature film, because I used to make film for adults in my short film. And I didn't believe that I would have this opportunity to make a feature film for adults. And I didn't want to spend time for my own story in adult to be, you know, crushed by the industry who will tell me that it's not possible. I didn't want to get involved in that. And one day, Marc du Pontavice called me from Xilam, and he wanted to adapt this book and to make something for adults. And he was thinking about me, because my short film was in some aspect, some connection with the film. And so it was like a gift and a very rare opportunity to do it. And when we tried to get funding and to get the interest of people, and when you start just saying it's about a severed hand, you'll be sure you get no funding, nothing. It's really hard to see poetry behind this very picture of severed hand at the first look. But in fact, the film is not about the severed hand, it's about the rest of the body. Mm-hmm. And it's about us, in fact, what is it to be human? What is it to experiment life when you're living in the present, stuck between your past, your future? And the film is about this existential quest. It's about love, loss. So there is all inside the story, but how you can say that on a pitch with a severed hand and a title like I Lost My Body. Mm-hmm. So we failed actually to get funding, and the producer has to put money. And but people are scared about that, you know, most of the time they, you know, for me the creation and art should be like the chaos into the system, and we have to accept when we want to things to evolve, to put a little sparks, chaotic sparks, and this is where things we make the system works, in fact. And people prefer to have all a very established. So it was a kind of a struggle to do it.
Well, it might have been, in a funny way, a good sign that people couldn't imagine how a film about a hand searching for its body could be all these wonderful things that is charming and entertaining and funny. The fact that it required a great filmmaker to provide that imagination maybe meant that it was a good idea all along. Hard to make. But it means that it's a totally original project, and of course no one could imagine that, because it had never been done before.
Yeah, that's why I don't blame the people who didn't give money for it, because at the same time they give us more time to develop the project alone with an independence. Mm-hmm. So it's a paradox, because we need money, and I thank them to not give us the money. But maybe next time, please give the money.
That's right.
So it's like we have to find a good balance, you know. And even today, I cannot pitch the film. It's really hard to pitch this film, right, because it's more about an experience than, you know, only a story with a storyline we all know. But it's more about you're not prepared to see that, and you have to be moved to travel in some area you were expect to go during
the
film.
The movie to me seems essentially about empathy. And can you know, what's so successful about the film to me is it helps me empathize with a hand and its journey, right?
Yeah.
And then I'm getting to know all of these, you know, lovely people and their internality. And it's all expressed, this is what's so amazing about animation, is it's expressed through movement. That the movement tells the story, The movement of that hand and the way it moves around has charm and character. And it's this essence of what is magical about animation, that it brings life to things that you don't realize have life. And I thought what's interesting is that on the one hand, in a very classical animated way, you're taking this inanimate hand and giving it character and life. And you're also, in very subtle ways, bringing life to the internal emotions mm-hmm. of these human characters. Do you want to talk about what it was like telling a story about both of those character sets?
Yeah, in fact, it was a big challenge of the book and of the film. And, I was really, when I read the book, of course, it evoked me some of the film of the cinema, like Adam's Family. Mm-hmm. With the Severton. I wanted to get away from all this reference we had,
right.
Because the film is a point of view film, so we doesn't have to look at the end, we have to be the end, we have to be inside the end.
Yeah.
And so give me this opportunity to play with the camera also, so to be very close to the hands. All was about the combination, find a good combination between how the hand will move, but also how I have to frame the hand. To be like in the world of the hand, just to have fragmented part of the story when we are with the hand, we don't see the context so much. We are really discovering the set with the tip of the finger, as the hand does, in fact. And yes, for the challenge was to not be too much too funny when the hand is walking, just mm-hmm. walking,
right.
And not too creepy. So I have to find something. Natural, as can be a separate hand, looks natural, mm-hmm. I mean. But it has to be like an animal's. Sometimes an animal's capable of being very reactive in an action, face to a danger, mm-hmm. to grab whatever it can grab next mm-hmm. to it. It's like improvisation. It was improvisation during the storyboard process, in fact, mm-hmm. most of time. And also the hand could have, emotion and sensibility when the hand is meeting a baby in the room. It's changed completely of what we just see with the combats of rats just before, for example.
Right, there's an action sequence with a hand. and it's interesting that the film crosses so many genres, mm-hmm. right? There's action sequences in it. There are these very subtle romantic scenes and there's comedy. And it's hard to describe.
I think this kind of concept is a gift for a director, because the concept justified to play with all the genre. You were talking mm-hmm. about destiny, and you're talking about little things who define the whole destiny. And the path of the hand, the epic travel of the hand, you have to express all this moment, really sketch, how do you mm-hmm. say, of life, you know, how is it to struggle again to survive?
Right.
So it has to be like surviving. And so for me, I can, when I was working on a action sequence and I need to rest a bit about the mm-hmm. storyboard, I can move to romantic sequence, because right. the film works because of the mix of this genre mm-hmm. with also memory and flashback. So it's a puzzle movie, in fact, and each pieces of the puzzle get the whole signification at the end. It's like connection.
What was it like to work off of a novel and make your own tone based on his tone, and was he involved in any way?
Of course, he was also on the co-script of the film.
All right.
So, yes, me, I used to start with my own materials, usually mm-hmm. in my short film, so it was the first time I had to start from a book. But what connect Guillaume to me is the use of the fantastic element, of the absurd eruption into realistic things. I mean, the hands allow us to see reality with a different angle. And without this fantastic element, it's not so easy to talk about thematic, which like memory, like loss, like all this memory in the film, all this thematic in the film. And I like this use of fantastic. We want to see reality with a fresh angle, and we need to be outside of reality to be able to look at reality. And it allows me to do that. So this was the connection between Guillaume and I. And of course, I had to bring the vision of the film, because I cannot ask Guillaume to betray the book. And it was my job to betray the book, because I knew what I'm going to do after with the film. And he was next to me to help me to make this works.
What were the biggest things that, in what ways did the film evolve the story of the book?
At first, you know, in the book, the hand is talking. It's talking to what happened when it was connected with the body, because it has to be to go with world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And at the beginning, we had a voiceover, mm-hmm. and but it was not working, because it kills the point of view. You know, when you are in the point of view, you want to be in the action, and you cannot accept to have a voiceover would grab you. And
so voiceover was distancing.
Yes,
and
exactly.
So you storyboarded and built the animatic with voiceover for the hand.
We start.
Yeah.
It was really when I started the storyboard, I was like, it's not going to work. So go back to the script.
Mm-hmm. What was it about taking the words out? How did it free you? Like, how did it make it easier to empathize with that hand?
I mean, when you you remove the voice of the hand, you really have only the five fingers to express, and you have to trust more than to be scared about that. You have to go to make this a strength. So you have to play with sensoriality, and it opened the field of all the cinematographic language of the film today, about sensoriality, the sound, and it helps the audience to be really involved into the mute world of a severed hand.
What I've felt mm-hmm. watching it is it invites you to project personality onto the hand, instead of the movie objectively telling you what it's
yes.
thinking. You're having to guess, and it creates a kind of engagement mm-hmm. that keeps you, you know, leaning into the screen instead of being told a story.
Yeah, and it brings also new things on the story. For example, I had to also to create a sensorial approach, sensorial relation between Naoufel and the world. So that was Naoufel is using microphone. Mm-hmm. He got connection through the world, through the sound also. The hand, it's tactile, and Naoufel is kind of same thing, the sound tactile for me. Mm-hmm. And it brings me to create this intercom sequence, which was not in the book. And also most of the element, like igloo and the fly, was not on the book also. Mm. The fly is the symbol of the destiny, and mm-hmm. because in the book it was expressed by world,
yes,
by word. I need to put something who can evocate the destiny into the film.
So I heard you had an unconventional way of working with the actors on this film. What was that?
Yes, we organized a shoot for recording the actor with camera and audio recording. Because, you know, when I wanted something very naturalistic and authentic, fragile. And animation is very, working in animation is a process very a box, you know. You know each step, you exactly know what you have. And I wanted to open the door to some improvisation. And I wanted the live action to the recording of the actors to give me that. And also I think when you talk in post-production through a bar, you are only projected with the voice.
Yeah.
And when you act, the body also talk mm-hmm. and project a part of the what you deliver. And yes, I wanted this feeling, because also to have something subtle, more close to live action than animation sometimes. It's not about the character in my film are not caricatural. So I need this kind of subtleness.
Well, it's very difficult to create spontaneity in animation, right? And what I love about your picture is it nothing feels stock. Mm. Everything feels like an observation and a specific choice.
This movie, I thought, had a lot of very interesting choices in sound and in music. You want to talk about that?
I think, yes, the music is a crucial element for me. It's like it brings the universe of the film. And I needed the music of Dan Levy, to raise all this daily situation, all this urban, life, to something very mystical and like we were in space. And I wanted the music to be able to build the link between all these pieces of a movie, between the past, between the hand pass and the character pass on the film. And it was for me necessary to keep the link through the music, transition, emotional transition through the music, to be able to not cut the film like that, but to follow one single pass with the emotion of the music. And when you have a mute character without a voice, it helps really to bring emotion, and you need that. And the film is really about sound also, and I was concerned to have sound design really integrate into the music, to be able to disappear in the wall of the city sometimes, and to start to move to music, and to start to disappear into sound design. I wanted this organic line.
I was going to say that we always try to be pushing the boundaries of what audiences can expect from animation, and it's such a huge medium, and there's so many different ways to tell stories. And so whenever we're approaching it, we're trying to figure out what is a way to do this that people haven't seen before, and what's the most groundbreaking way this could be done. I think that's really true of your film. It really feels like it is. It's pushing the boundaries even further, so thanks.
Yeah, because there is no boundaries for animation. I mean, the only boundaries we have is the industry who will put the boundaries. Mm-hmm. And today we don't have boundaries with technique. We can, on the purpose, thematic we want to talk. So to us to bring this to people, to bring this curiosity, this diversity in cinema and in animation also.
Well, there were 30 movies that qualified, right, for eligibility for the Oscars, which is exciting because there's the sheer volume of work. But to us, we're at the start of a golden age of animation, you know, because one of the exciting things about Spider-Verse was how ready the audience was to be surprised. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the work of the emerging filmmakers in the animation space, people are trying so many different things. And what's so encouraging about your movie is not only how innovative it is, but how audiences respond to it. Young people and adults both are able to engage with the film. And it's just encouraging that the audience is there for unusual approaches with animated features. And I think yours is an amazing example of that.
Right. Yeah, well, you're using every cinematic tool to tell this story. You know, Chris and I love funny, wacky dialogue, and our movies are filled with, you know, words.
Yeah.
But I really admire how your film doesn't rely on that stuff.
Congratulations. It really is a very special, original, fun, and engaging movie. So
it's daring.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.